First of all, thank you to everyone who's here tonight and for coming and being involved, allowing your kid the opportunity to participate in high school athletics. This is one of those meetings, as we go through things, that I know is something that everybody doesn't look forward to. As a parent, there's things that we are involved in, that there's rules and procedures and things that we go through. I know I talked to Matt Comstock and Bell Fountain today. They're doing their meeting tonight as well. It's really more one of those things that is a procedural thing that we have to do. That being said, I also want it to be something, hopefully, that you can learn from. If you have questions, you can come ask me questions in the end. And we can hopefully make it informative and help you out. First of all, just to begin, my name is Scott Orr. I'm the Activities Director here at the high school. In your hand, you have a handout that everything that is on the slides. That being said, my contact information and everything is on there if you need to get a hold of me at any time or for anything. Our first thing that we're going to talk about tonight, normally Mr. Butler, our principal, talks about tonight, but he's in another meeting at the same time. So that being said, I'm going to go ahead and cover our eligibility to participate. Basic fundamental requirements to be eligible or to participate is each kid in the high school, each 9 weeks is when we determine grades, must pass 75% of their classes. Passing must be a D or better. An F does not pass the class. A D does pass the class. So per 9 weeks, we check grades. And each 9 weeks, they have to pass at least 75% of their classes. From the sophomore year on, it's pretty easy to figure it out because with the block scheduling, most of our kids take 4 classes. So it's very easy that if they pass 3 out of 4, that they're good and they may participate. In addition to that, their GPA must be at least a 1.5 or better. I understand as parents that you want your student to be better than a 1.5. So do I, and so are the majority of our kids that are participating in sports. That being said, there has to be a standard set at some level. And in saying that, surprisingly, you know, we will have kids that won't make it, that are ineligible. So that being said, our standard is set at a 1.5. They must have at least a 1.5 or better to be involved in any sport that they would like to participate in. In addition to that, if they have a 1.5 to a 1.75, we provide study tables for those kids to help them out and hopefully get them in better academic standing so they're not in that situation in the future. The bottom of this slide is something that is very important and a lot of our student athletes struggle with or forget or want to forget or whatever, but they must be at school by 9 a.m. and can't leave before 2:15 in order to participate in our athletic activity that evening. When I say athletic activity, that might be practice, that may be a game. It could be a lot of different scenarios. Now, there are exceptions to that. For example, if there's a death in the family and the student is attending a funeral, if they've got a doctor's appointment, if there's certain things that they attend, for example, with a doctor's appointment, they should come back with a note. They should come back with something to say, here's where I was, I attended the doctor, that's why I'm arriving at 10:15 or 11 o'clock or whatever. We will have the situation we have every year of a kid that'll sign in at 9:03, 9:10, 9 whatever, and reason is overslept. They will not participate that day. I will find them throughout the day, bring them down to the office, say, here's what happened this morning. And 9 times out of 10, the kids are incredibly honest. Mr. Rule, this is what happened. I'm sorry. And I always say, hey, I feel for it. I understand. But in the same sense, we have to have guidelines. We have to have rules. And this is what it is, and you're not able to participate. Again, we will go through that some. It's not something that's over and over and a common thing, but I want to make sure as parents, in order to participate, they must be there by 9, and again, can't leave before 2:15. And the way that we determine that is a half of a block for block scheduling. Our next thing, forms the kids must have in order to participate. And I will give you one of these forms tonight if you do not have it. My guess is that every person in this room has already seen all of these forms arrive to the house and are probably already signed and are already returned. I've had a number of coaches that have already come into me and said, here's everyone on our team. Everybody is complete. And that's the way we want to do it. We want it to be in, we want it to be efficient, and get paperwork completed. But the five forms that every kid must have on file to participate is a physical exam, a concussion information form, the Marion Tan HIPAA form, the emergency medical code of conduct form, and the new form with Lindsay's Law that is required this year is the sudden cardiac arrest form. Both the sudden cardiac arrest as well as the concussion form are both informational pieces where you have information about that, and then you sign that, yes, we have received information from the school on concussion information as well as sudden cardiac arrest. Okay, so the sudden cardiac arrest, again, is something that's completely new. If you need these forms, they are on the school website. If you go to the high school, you go to athletics, the very first icon on the left is athletic forms and downloads. You can click that and all the forms are right there. So all of these forms are online if you don't already have them. Also, another common question that we get asked is the physical exam form, how long is it good? It's good for one calendar year. So once you get a physical, it is good 1 year from that point forward. The next thing I want to talk a little bit about, one of our last forms there was code of conduct, is our Benjamin Logan code of conduct. And that being said, what I always urge with the code of conduct is don't just sign it and return it, as well as a lot of the other forms that you get, but spend some time with your student athlete, make sure they understand, make sure they know what is involved in that code of conduct. We do have things within our code of conduct that we expect our athletes and kids involved in athletics to be at a little bit higher standard, a good citizen, a good model for our community, but do things the right way versus other students that are also just students in our building, okay? And that being said, there are things within our code of conduct. If a kid breaks a violation of the code of conduct, and some of those I've got at the top, some of the common violations, the high school principal will just make a ruling on. If we click on Peak of Ohio or the examiner or whatnot, and we hear if one of our athletes was involved in this or that or whatever, that is something, again, that Mr. Butler will make a decision on. And again, those are things that could be anything from missing games, being dismissed from the team, to some type of community service or something that we come up with that we feel is fitable to that punishment or to the action that they were involved in. So again, there are things like that in the code of conduct. Now, in addition to that, violations that include alcohol, tobacco, and drugs are all standard within the code of conduct as far as how much of their season they miss due to a violation. And those are listed there on your handout as well, but 20% for the first offense, 365 days for the second, and then the third offense, they're no longer able to be involved in athletics here at Benjamin Logan. As a credit to you as parents, we have very, very few first offenses. We have hardly any second offenses. This is my 11th year, and with that being said, we hardly ever see a second offense. So as a blessing to you guys as parents, doing a great job raising kids and teaching them values and good things in life and good decisions, good choices, what to do. We do have some violations, but very, very few. Again, the last thing I've got there, I always urge everybody, make sure you and your athletes understand our code of conduct and our rules before just signing it and turning it in. Next, I'm going to introduce our athletic training staff. We've got Ms. Baer that is here tonight. I'm going to pass the mic over to her and let her talk just a little bit about our athletic training program and who they are and what they're here to do for us.
Hello. Addie was here. She had to run back out to practice, so she stuck me in here talking to everybody. So, hi. Before I get started with what's up here on this slide, we are both here after school at various times. I'm here all day because I teach here. So if you need something, if you've noticed something at home, you can call the school and just ask for my voicemail, and leave a voicemail that way. There are many people sitting out there who have my cell phone number. The best way to contact me is probably that way, and probably a text message more than a phone call, because it just picks up better all throughout the school. I won't be able to get back to you until after school, but feel free to call, leave a message if you notice something at home. You can also contact Addie very easily. Her number is actually written down right outside of our training room, and I'm sure some of you have her number too. We don't care when you call. You can call anytime, and that's fine. It could be a Sunday, we don't care. We're perfectly okay with that. Addie covers more after school than I do. I'm here a couple nights a week. She's here a few. So you may see her more than me. It's just the way it's set up now. She's contracted out of Mary Rutan, and I work through the school. So that's just how that is set up. First thing we need to talk about are doctor's notes. The basic thing that you need to remember, the easiest thing to remember, is if your son or daughter goes to anyone to see a medical sports-related situation outside of the school, if they see someone besides Addie or I, we need to have a written note that releases them. If we don't have a written note that releases them, we can't let them participate. It's high law, state law, they follow. So if they have sprained an ankle and we've looked at it, we've evaluated it, it's not getting better, we'll try to not send them out if that's your wish and work with them here, or we'll send them right away if that's what you want to do. One of us typically will call, get a hold of you, and do a plan with you. And if we do send them out of the school to have treatment, we need that written release that says they're okay to go. Without that, we can't let them participate. They can't practice, they can't do anything. Concussion protocols are pretty much the same as they were last year as far as a return to play. The biggest thing we want to know about concussion is, if you see something strange at home again, please let us know. They may have been acting okay here, they may have taken a hit to their head, and they may have been acting okay, and then later that night they're not. That would be something that we would want to know about, so we'll obviously be checking with them, but we may not have even have known that they took a hit, and they may tell you no. So the concussion, as far as the protocols and return to play, we'll get them back in and run them through protocols, but we need to know if they were hit and you're seeing any signs and symptoms at home. We work a lot with Mary Tan and their concussion clinic. We also have athletes that go through Nationwide Children's and their concussion clinic, so there are a lot of different avenues we can take there. We also do a return to school protocol that we can fill you in on if need be. That's really it. You're going to talk about the new... Okay. Do you have any questions for us? Or for me? Is that enough? All right. Thanks.
The last thing Chris was saying there to me was, did you already talk about the new paperwork, the sudden cardiac arrest? And again, you've already seen that. If you need another copy or you'd like another copy of it, I'll give it to you. Again, you can find a lot of stuff online about that, videos and different things that you can view with the new laws and everything with sudden cardiac arrest. The biggest thing with all this, I would urge and say to you, the biggest reminder with Chris, if your son or daughter goes to the doctor, always return with a note that says, I am allowed to participate, or I am not allowed to participate, and this is my instructions for our athletic trainers. That is the biggest thing, again, that I can say to you over and over, as we see kids return, and they'll say, my doctor said they're going to fax the physical, or they said they're going to fax the note, or they're going to email the note. Well, you know how that goes. They were sitting and waiting on that, and they're wanting to play and be involved and be in practice and do things. So again, the biggest thing I can remind you with all that is, if your son or daughter attends a doctor, please have that doctor return with a note of instruction for our trainers. That being said, Addie is not here tonight. I know a lot of you have probably seen Addie Pissarro. Again, her information is there on that. We're very fortunate that is a trainer that is provided for us through Mary Rutan. That is why we have the Mary Rutan HIPAA form that has passed out. That's the reasoning for that. And that's a service that Mary Rutan pays every dime of it for her salary and her hours spent, which is a full hourly work week and beyond here being involved in athletics. So it's great to grab that second trainer and be able to cover more stuff, have more people on the field, more eyes out there, and more involved. So we really appreciate that. Our next slide, parents and fans of games. The biggest things that I ask as an AD, and a lot of people always say, well, what is our expectations? Our expectations of our fans would be positive and be supportive. And as a fan, a lot of times I think during the process, you know if you're being positive and supportive or not. But there is nothing tougher than being a 13, 14, 15, 16, 17-year-old kid and having to perform under pressure. And a lot of times some big-time pressure. You look at us in Indian Lake last year in football when there's 3,000 people in the stands and it's going crazy and it's loud. That's a tough pressure situation. You look at kids on the golf course and there's people watching and they're all around and it's dead quiet and completely silent. Those are pressure situations. So for kids to perform in some of those clutch situations at the age they are is incredibly tough. It's really, really hard. And our coaches are working to encourage, to help them improve, to be better. As a parent and a fan, again, one of the best things we can do is, you know, encourage and be positive with them. There's going to be many times where they come home to you as a parent and they may be frustrated, they may be upset. One of the best things that I heard, and it was actually Bob Fawcett told me this. He said one of the best things sometimes a parent can say to their kid when they come home or they're frustrated is, hey, I love watching you play. I love watching you play and have fun doing that as a parent. Because then to that kid, it's something that's supportive. It's not, you know, well, you should have done this or you should have done that. If you've been over here or been over there, it's one of those things that to the kid they can relax because they know their parent, they just enjoy being a part of it and watching them play. So again, be supportive. Support all of our kids. I always say when you go to a game, you never know who's sitting next to you, whether it be a fan from the other team, or whether it be a parent of that kid out there that's number 13 or 12 or whatever, might be their parent that's right there next to you, you have no idea. So again, be supportive, be positive, and remember that we're all supporting not just our kids, but our community, our school, and everything involved. So again, those are my expectations. If you do have situations throughout the year, again, I always ask, please follow the chain of command. All of our coaches are willing to talk to you. I know sometimes it's one of those things where no one may ever perfectly agree, but that being said, they will talk to you. And you're welcome as a parent to do that. The thing I always ask is proper time and place, and usually that's not right before a game, during a game, or after a game. You know, as a parent and a student athlete, if you go home and you're frustrated, emotions are high, rest on it a little bit. Take some time before you send an email or something and reach out to that coach. Because after a game, everybody's emotional. Especially if it's a 1-0 soccer game and it's tight at the very end and everybody's involved and everybody's into it and we either maybe get a stop or don't get a stop, everybody's emotional in that situation. So again, as a parent, if you'd like to talk to a coach, you're welcome to do so. That being said, I always say, number one, please give your student-athlete the opportunity to do that first. They come to you as a parent. Mom, I'm upset about this. Dad, I'm upset about that. Go talk to your coach. Go talk to your coach. Go spend some time with them. Sit down with coach. Can I talk to you for a second? You know, I feel like I'm doing this or that or whatever. Maybe, what can I do better? What can I improve on? How can I help our team more? But encourage them to go talk to their coach and be involved before you as a parent do. From there, again, if the student athlete or you would like to talk to me, more than welcome to talk to you. And again, right on down the chain of command as far as Mr. Butler and then our superintendent. Things very, very rarely, as we talked about before with our code of conduct, get that far down the chain of command. But that being said, please encourage the student athlete. After that, if you feel like you need to contact the coach or myself, please do so. The biggest thing that athletics teach us, in my opinion, is life lessons. Winning is always something that excites everybody. It always makes us feel good. It makes us feel like we're going the right direction. It makes us feel like we're doing a lot of positive things. But that being said, it's not the ultimate lesson that we learn being involved in high school athletics. There are so many life lessons that we learn in dealing with adversity, when we're tired, having to continue to compete, the hard work, the teamwork. Maybe I'm not always the best, but I'm an important piece of this team. There's so many things that you learn in that. So to me, please let all those lessons work and teach us things beside just worrying about whether we win or lose. From there, communication for the athlete will help them learn and grow for later in life. There's nothing that's going to teach them responsibility when they go to college or get a job better than learning to communicate now as a student. When we talk about learning to communicate, that is both them relaying information home to you, as far as what's coming up, is there a parent meeting tonight? I didn't realize there was a parent meeting, you just told me 5 minutes ago. To picture day, to game got changed because it rained, or the other team doesn't have enough for JV, so we can't play JV. Will we post those things? Will I tweet those things? Will I send them out? Absolutely. But in addition to that, as an athlete, what a great opportunity for them to learn to communicate and improve at that skill for later in life. So again, one of the best things that they can learn to do is to communicate with you and help you as a parent. Last thing I've got on there, and I started talking about this last year, but this has become the great enabler of all of us in life. And I say encourage them to talk to the coach, because it's so easy to just walk. Hey, did you talk to your coach? I sent them a text. Did you talk to your coach? Did you talk to them? Because ultimately, again, that's what's going to teach them how to face-to-face communicate and grow, where it's going to help them down the road. So again, just encourage them. Go talk to your coach. Don't just send them a text. Don't just send them an email. You know, make sure as an athlete and a part of that team, talk to them and learn to communicate. Last couple of things I've got, booster clubs. I can't urge you enough to get involved and help out. We had a boosters meeting last night. We had probably 20 in our athletic boosters meeting last night, which is a great number to have. That being said, you know, one of the booster members said to me last night, a good, I guess, quote or thing to think about is, if everybody does a little, nobody has to do a lot. So please, please get involved with them in some way. Attend meetings. Sometimes there's things within those groups you can do that you didn't even realize. Maybe you can just help them put stuff online with their Facebook page. Or maybe you can take care of their website. Maybe you can be involved with apparel sales and setting that up and getting forms out. Things that are very, very simple that don't require, I'm going to say the word, working the concession stand every single game, okay? And that is a, I'm telling you, when you watch that football concession stand on Friday nights and there's 25 people in there hustling, working as hard as they can, that is a tough, tough job. But that being said, that's not the only thing the boosters do. They do so many different things. So again, first Wednesday of every month, we'll meet in room 104, which is across from the library, 6:30. Again, please come to a meeting and just listen, learn, find out maybe how you can be involved in different things you can do. Our next group, they're at the bottom, the Music Boosters. They meet the first Tuesday of every month. They meet in the high school band room. And again, they do so many things for our kids here in school. So again, please take the opportunity, be engaged, and get involved with what we do. Additional information that you might be interested in, passes will go on sale on Monday of next week, the 7th, at 10 a.m. We have everything set up, we're ready to go, we're ready to sell our passes. Passes are $50 for a student, $100 for an adult, $300 for a family. If you can do the quick math on that, if you have more than two kids and you go to a lot of stuff, once you get above two kids and with a family pass, at some point they pay for themselves incredibly quickly. Central Buckeye Conference ticket prices, I don't have up there, but Central Buckeye Conference ticket prices are 6 and 4 for varsity games. Varsity football at the gate, everything is $6, but we do offer a $4 student ticket during the day or any time. They can come in the first day of the school year and buy 5 student tickets and have tickets for the whole season the first day. But again, that is up to them to take advantage of that. We will have everything will be 6-4 at the gate for volleyball, for soccer, for all our other sports, with the exception of football. Again, football is the only one that is $6. All tickets are $6 at the gate. And again, that's because we do the pre-sale tickets for football. So the students still have an opportunity for a $4 ticket, but they don't have that opportunity at the gate. Passes, when you do the math on that, 5 football games, $6 a piece, $30 for 5 of them. And a lot of students go to 5 football games. Student pass is $50. You get your money back pretty quick as soon as they call you and say, hey mom, I'm going to volleyball. Hey mom, I'm going to soccer tonight. Hey mom, I'm going to go back to volleyball game tonight. It's good for basketball. It's good for middle school. It's good for stuff in the spring. It's good for track. So again, those passes are year long, and they save a lot of money if you have a student that's very involved and going to a lot of different things. So again, I would urge you to think about that, and if that's an opportunity for you, please take advantage of it. Those passes are on sale during the day. You can just write a check and send it in with your student. We've got all the back to school days and stuff going on here pretty soon where you can pick up schedules. You can buy a pass then. Again, you can get individual passes, you can get family passes, whatever type of scenario works best for you. They are only good for home games, so when we play at Graham, it won't be good. It'll only be good for Ventura Logan home games. And also, it is only good for regular season games. So when we have the Quest Cup tip-off the Quest Cup tournament, a track tournament, basketball tournament stuff, they will not be accepted for those. Reason being, when we have tournaments or invitationals, there are additional expenses on our end versus a regular season game. That being said, when you remove all your soccer, when you remove the Quest Cup from the schedule, they still play 8 more home games. So they're still, you know, as a parent, you're still going to spend nearly $50 for one parent on just home soccer games. So again, it's something, if you attend very many things, again, I would think about that opportunity because they will save you money and make it easier. Schedules are online. They are online right now. Ms. Lee, Jocelyn Lee, is now working on our website, which is new this year to the high school. She already has all our athletic schedules up, so if you were to go right now, you would go to Benjamin Logan, and then you would go to high school, and then you click on athletics, and all the teams drop down, and you click on boys soccer schedules, boom, they'll pop up. She has them online right now. Do they look really, really neat? Not yet. I think she'll make them look very neat, and they'll be clean and easy to read, but they are there. They are there if you want to go view them and you want to see them. And we will do our best through her to keep those updated. The fall's a little bit better than the spring as far as less cancellations and makeups and things like that. But we will do our absolute best to keep those updated when we get into rain and weather situations and things like that. But again, schedules are all online right now. Picture day. Mr. Rose and his wife handed out forms as you enter. Picture day is Wednesday of next week. The kids will get a schedule and a time. We'll pretty much take them all throughout the entire day. One thing that someone asked about earlier that I want to make sure we cover, seniors get a banner when they are a senior. That is a 3x5, is that accurate? Close? Close, 3x5 banner of every senior that's involved in our sports teams. That you do not pay for that as a parent. So you don't need to check that on your form and mark to pay for that or anything like that. That cost is taken care of. Our teams fundraise and do different things throughout the year that we can use that as a gift to our seniors when they graduate. So again, those banners are all paid and taken care of. So if you have a question as far as senior banners, they're done. They're done, they're taken care of. We'll have them up for games and everything when they get started. The last couple things I've got here, first day of school, I know everybody's excited, especially parents probably. Wednesday, August 16th, first day back to school. Also, if you'd like to follow us on Twitter, a lot of our teams do have Twitter pages, Instagram pages, whatnot. I do our athletic Twitter account, so if you'd like to follow us on Twitter, it's just @BLHS_athletics. If you're not a Twitter person, I wasn't 2 years ago either, If you're not a Twitter person and you're not into the social media, but you will go to a website, the Twitter feed is on our website. So if you can just go to High School Athletics, Twitter feed's right there. As soon as a game gets canceled, rescheduled, make up, boom, we tweet it, you can see it right there on the website. So it's the most instant, easy, quickest way to get information as far as cancellation, reschedules, delays, different things like that. We will send it on Twitter. And then also, like I said earlier, our website is at benjaminlogan.org. Individual parent meetings. From here, we're going to move into different team meetings. I believe every team is having a meeting tonight with the exception of football and what's my own? Girls golf. There we go. They play tomorrow morning. Football and girls golf are the only two that are not having a group meeting tonight. So those are all the areas that are listed there to where teams are. I'll quickly go through them. Cheerleading is in the comments. Volleyball is in the gym. Girls soccer and boys soccer. Room 403 is Coach Hughes' classroom. 402 is Coach Tuttle. It's her classroom. So as you go to the quad and make a right, both of those are down that way. So as you go to the, if you go toward the end of the building and you get to the area where all the halls break, make a right, and both of those rooms are there. Boys golf is in the library, which is again just on that end of the building. Across from the library is rooms 103 and 104. And 103 is girls cross country, and 104 is boys cross country. Again, the last thing I've got for you, the biggest reminder, no one wants to go to this twice in 1 year. So that being said, there are sign-in sheets in the back. Make sure that you as a parent list your son or daughter's name. Sibling, you can list a sibling there as well. And sign in so that we know of your attendance. So that we, as we check each roster, I'm able to say to the coaches, these are the parents that have attended, these are the parents that need to watch our video and still attend our meeting. So again, thank you for being here tonight. Greatly appreciate it. As you leave, we have some booster members that are in the back. They have clipboards. They're not going to attack you and beat you with them or anything like that as you leave. If you'd like to give your cell number and your email just so they can send you stuff when they have meetings and when things are coming up, they'll gladly take it down. They're not going to, again, ask everyone that leaves and make it tough to get out. But if you want to give them your information as you leave so they can send stuff to you, again, they're in the back. If you have questions, please come see me. That way everybody else is welcome to go. Again, thank you for coming out tonight. And before you know it, this weekend, we'll be playing scrimmages and playing games. So good luck to everybody. Thank you.